and 575 syllables ended with a twist. So I maintain a novelty Drupal Twitter account called Drupal Haikus, and here's some more Drupal Haiku examples. Hello, D6 site. Are your modules up to date? I'll need some coffee. So I find that with Haikus, we can describe aspects of our jobs as Drupal developers. We can talk about specific functions. Drupal execute, the only hammer you need. Where did these groups come from? I think it's a shame that I'm presenting opposite Jeff Eden, because I think he'd really appreciate that one, as are all the people who wrote Drupal execute. Also, our work, div class class, div class, div span, words, close div, close div, close span, close div, close div, close div, sign. I hope with the new modules we get in 8, then we'll have less of classes and divs just everywhere. So those are the haikus, and then there's the question of what's a plugin.
So, I don't know if you're here for the haikus or for CTools plugins. I'm here for the haikus, you know. So, a plugin is basically really generic, is a component extend or replace code or, you know, place it in your application and use it. So, plugins and discrete abilities to your side are simply required, you know, because it's, you always need to load something else besides the plugin.
So, as plugins and haikus, again, my name is Steve Birch. I'm a senior engineer at Palantir.net. All over the web, you can follow me as Steve Vector on Drupal.org, on Twitter, on GitHub, and go present you with me and Pedro again.
Well, I'm Pedro Camara, I work for those guys, and I'm Pete Camara in Drupal.org, on Twitter, and everywhere else. I am a community leader, elected director for the Drupal Association, so if you like having some guys and have any questions,
session that's on Thursday. This session is going to focus mainly on Drupal 7 plugins. Certain plugins connected to the CTools module. A lot of those concepts, as Peter just said, have made their way to Drupal 8. And on Thursday, you can find out a lot more about how these concepts have changed into Drupal 8.
So just know these.
And like I said, it'll be the first of many reminders. So let's start inside the panels universe of plugins. Can I get a show of hands? Here has either worked with panels, is vaguely familiar with panels. Okay, so a large portion, almost everybody. So a haiku for panels, controlling a layout with in-browser editing, Drupal 8's white whale. I say Drupal 8's white whale simply because a lot of the initiative, the scholarship initiative, a lot of the major VR time I get to the end, I don't know exactly what I did, and I won't know if it worked. So, you started a screen like this, and you've got this concept of variance. I want to configure a layout that will just work for vertical nodes. So, the next thing I see is something like this. I want to set a condition saying, this is my layout configuration only for the node type vertical. This is a pretty basic configuration. That's common when controlling layout nodes with panels, varying your layout type just based on node type. You can get more complicated. I might need to control my layout for, this is the vertical content type. It's used when the user is logged in, and maybe when I'm on this specific domain in domain nodes. So you can get very granular with these permissions. In this example, it's just node type is vertical. You then get to this place where you can add more contexts. We have the context of the node. We know that we need to display the username and picture of the author who created this node. So we make the relationship to the user context. We then pick our layout, one that has two columns, and let us put the body in one column and the username and picture in another. We then put stuff in the layout. That body of the node, the username, user picture, and then we cross our fingers and hope that it worked. And it's difficult to know, did this work? Really, the only way to answer that question is to go to a node that you think is applicable to the layout that was just configured and see, is this what I expected? Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. And if you didn't get what you expected, what are your options? I can Google the problem, I can look at every online resource, Stack Exchange, the issue queue, and just look to find something that sounds like the problem that I think I can. I could ask somebody, I had some coworker, I could ask somebody, or see if you could look for documentation, either in the BB file or Drupal.org documentation. Or I can look at the code, and that's often where I lean, and I imagine people in the coding tribe, that's a place you would lean to as well. And I don't have a great answer for when exactly you go to each of these. That's a difficult question that you have to answer problem to problem. But assuming you do go to the code, what do you do then? You can just start dropping these debug statements everywhere that the develop module gives us. You can put TSMs and DPMs all over the place. You can go right to the markup and look at class names to try and get clues or print out whatever templates you think are applicable. You can use your IDE's debugger and just start at index.php and work your way through the whole request. The advice I'm giving in this presentation is if you're working with panels, go straight to the relevant plugin funnel. Now, what do I mean by that? So I'm going back to our example here. We started with that access condition, that idea that we only want this layout to be applicable when we have the node type as being equal to the article. So these are called access plugins, and I'll begin my explanation of access plugins with a haiku here. So we give it a context and some configuration. We get back true or false. So we'll look at some code here. This is the code that is the node type access plugin. Coming into this function, we've got a configuration variable, and we've got a context variable. I've rewritten it here slightly just to get to fit on the slide. But all that's happening here is we're taking our node object, looking at the node type property on that object, seeing if that string is in the configuration array. If so, return true. If not, return false. That's all that's happening inside an access plugin. We've got context, configuration, and returning true or false. And in an example as simple as node type is a vertical, it's unlikely that you'll need to go into the plugin file to see what's happening. But if you have node type equals a vertical, and user is logged in, and domain is this, and you're not getting the behavior expected, it's difficult to know which plugin file is giving you the behavior you don't expect. I think your best option in that case is to just go straight to the plugin file, put debug statements at the beginning of the function and the end of the function, see what's coming in, what's coming out, and do you see what you expect? So, when you're debugging plugins, the plugin exists to implement one function. Debug in there first. So in this access plugin, the node type, like a reminder to go to the Drupal 8 plugin system deep dive session, because this has completely changed in Drupal 8. We've got a lot more object-oriented principles in Drupal 8. So the problem space in Drupal 8 has completely changed, and this session is the best place to go to find out how things are changing in the super movies. Those are more reminders. So now relationship plugins. So we said we have that note.
tags that can be used and this kind of function in a percentage and things like that, right? But they don't have the label. So in this string here, that says store administration string, that will try to find a label, and there is none in the identity variable field. So instead of having a huge form address to provide a new widget for linking the order with the Google, we can just data, the sort wasn't really in the database. We had all the title, the images, the descriptions in the database, but not the sort, not the weight, if you want to call it that. So that was in a web service elsewhere. So an alternative to for this would have been like modifying substantially views to not use a sort plugin, to not use the database plugin for sorting. So instead, Draggableviews extends them in OOP, the views sorting, and provides you with a get and set. So it gets the sort and it sets the sort. Get it gets the sort when it lists the records, and it sets it when you release, when you drag and release. So this way we could list the external data with just overwriting the set when the user releases the record. It will call the web service and update the web service, so we avoid to modify the views, to add views, and also to, or even doing a big synchronization with that. A couple of examples from our research web visits are these filters here. So you can filter your search results. That's coming from Facet API. That's a very, very good one for managing search. So there is an example of what plugins can do for you in Facet API. There is this Facet API bonus model that allows you to not display the facet that doesn't really have any result. So if you have a search that returns 7 results, you have a facet that allows you to filter by 7, that facet is not really useful, right? So you can
you a chance to ask us any plugin questions, please pose as haikus. And there aren't any haikus.